Thank you, Mark. That's Mark Salmon, and he'll be playing some other amazing pieces of Franz Liszt. But right now, I'm hoping that you may still have fresh in your memory the music you heard while finding your seats tonight. That was Franz Liszt Angel Choir, or Angel de Chor de Angel, which he wrote in 1850 when Liszt was 49 years old. Here he composes a church prayer with a harp accompanying a full a cappella chorus. His use of harp and chorus creates an ethereal, new, completely unique music for that time, and was largely forgotten until the 20th century. But Mark then came on stage and opened with the Toccata, which was composed some 30 years later in 1880 when Liszt is 69. Since Liszt lived so long, it's impossible in 2 hours to give justice to each period of his rich life. It was an amazing 74 years of world history from 1811 to 1886, a period that saw the end of slavery, serfdom. The modern map of Europe started to take place, a momentous time, the rise of non-agrarian economies, the huge cities that we see today, greater literacy and industrial labor movements, yet still periodic famines and revolutions. Liszt witnessed all of this, continually working to promote music, mostly of other composers and musicians, but as well as students to his last days. I would venture to say that as a percentage of what Liszt earned, he literally stopped working for money when he was age 38. So he had a long retirement. But he probably gave away to charity, to students, to composers and other artists, nearly 50% of his fortune. In Liszt's generosity had met the notion, genie oblige, a phrase Liszt coined, meaning the duty and obligation you have when you are a genius. Quite an elegant man, to say the least. He was quite a looker. 6 foot, blonde straight hair, green eyes. Many people, men and women, commented on how he would cause a room to go silent when he walked in. But tonight we're going to explore the divergent personalities that make up the life of the man who composed these first two pieces and others we will hear tonight. History's first international rock star, a bravura performer who needed no royal patronage but supported himself, his family, friends, and a long retirement by just selling tickets to a paying audience. This was a first. He was also a conductor, perfecting the performance of Beethoven's Ninth, which up until Liszt conducted, was considered the work of an insane man and couldn't be done. Liszt proved that wrong. He also premiered Wagner's Tristan and Isolde as the conductor. He was teacher, festival organizer, philanthropist. And perhaps if you were walking the streets of Rome in the 1870s, you would have seen this old man walking by dressed as an abbey. Because by the 1860s and 1870s, Liszt had taken minor orders in the church and was then known from then on as Abbe Liszt. And then this is Liszt in his final years. And what I've noticed with the photos is that Liszt really keeps himself in good shape until about 70. And I will discuss later why he sort of just let himself go after the age of 70. But this is one of the last pictures of him in his studio in Weimar. As you can see, condensing the life of Franz Liszt into an hour of music and 40 minutes of lecture is a near impossible feat. Of all the great geniuses of the last three centuries, Liszt remains the least explored or understood. We'll do our best this evening to remedy that oversight. In the last lecture, we explored how Chopin wrote music uniquely pianistic and basically only for the piano. Liszt wrote for an orchestral piano. He's exploring new sounds and techniques which no one had tried before, and most did not have the technique even to try it. So what he's doing to the piano, bringing in orchestral sounds and sound effects, he will eventually then also do in his writings for orchestra, chorus, and chamber music. But let's first meet our performers tonight. Pianist Mark Salmon, and Mark, if you can stand up, I don't know if they can see you there. Many of you remember Mark from the last lecture playing some fantastic pieces of Chopin. Mark has been hailed as a heroic virtuoso and a dazzling performer. He performed in Seattle Chopin Celebration, which was a series of three recitals celebrating the composer's 200th birthday. And then the next year, honoring Liszt's 200th birthday in 2011. Mark recently released a recording of the late Schubert sonatas and Chopin's intimate art, the mazurkas, which we heard a good deal of in the last lecture. Mark is a native of Connecticut, began his studies at age 8 and made his first recital debut at age 11. A graduate of the Juilliard School of Music, Mark also studied at MIT for 2 years, concentrating on chamber music and composition. Mark lives and teaches in Seattle. And then also tonight, we will be featuring soprano Holly Johnson. Holly will be singing three songs of Franz Schubert that I'll accompany her on. Holly is originally from San Clemente, California, came to Seattle to study voice at Cornish College of the Arts. In 2004, Holly pursued her studies in Indonesia to explore local art forms at colleges across the Indonesian archipelago. While studying traditional Sudanese song on the island of Java, Holly met her husband, Otang Duram. And then in 2009, Holly and Oi made Vashon their home, along with their two darling girls, Utisa and Wally. I am Michael Tracy, and I'll be your host and lecturer tonight. I'm a resident of Vashon since 2011, an amateur pianist and musicologist in my free time. I do want to thank Vashon Center for the Arts for hosting us tonight. And I can't think of a more intimate space to explore such beautifully acoustic music as we will tonight. Thank you. By the way, the program is 2 hours long, so if you need to get up for a break, no big deal. I mean, it's nature, right? All I ask is that you do it while I'm talking and not during the music. So I won't take offense, but I'd rather. Also, I know it's very enticing to pull out your cell phone and start taking a video of what you're seeing tonight. But I do ask everybody instead to hit on your cell phone if you haven't already and do it so that it actually turns off. Because if you're trying to take a video, the person beside you is being distracted constantly between your video taking and what's really happening on stage. We do have a video recording artist here who is recording the whole lecture, and that will be on Voice of Vashon. So, there will be a record of this for you to go back to. So I'd appreciate that. Thank you so much. Liszt's genius is hard to find a comparison. Even as a child, the first time he read a score, he knew it by heart. In his old age, he could read for the first time, that means at sight, the handwritten piano concerto of Edvard Grieg. This is quite a difficult piano concerto. It is up there in one of the top 10 most difficult to play. Grieg wrote back to his family in Norway, detailing his amazement at such genius, as Liszt was not only reading at sight and playing it, both orchestra and piano, but Liszt said he was reading 3 pages ahead of what he was playing. Yeah. And one of the issues I think Liszt has as a composer, and for us as a listener to grapple with, is that he knew everybody's music. I mean, he knew all the Beethoven symphonies, all the Beethoven sonatas, all the Mozart sonatas. He knew most of the Bach preludes and fugues. And he could transcribe these easily to piano. So when it came to developing his own style, he had in his memory banks Chopin, Beethoven, Berlioz, Wagner. And what you find with Liszt music is that he can be Italian one moment, he can be French one day, German the next, Hungarian very much so. He's really truly the first international artist of the world. He was born in October 1811 at the time of the massive 1811 Great Comet. A lot of comments were made, of course, by Liszt and his contemporaries about the coincidence. Was this an omen? Though his birthplace today is in Austria, back then it was considered part of Hungary, and Liszt always considered his origin to be Hungarian. By the age of 10, Liszt's father, Adam, brings him to Vienna to study under Czerny and Salieri. By the age of 12, Adam moves the family to Paris, hoping to have Liszt enrolled into the Paris Conservatory. But the Clementi, who was the director then, said they had too many foreign pianists already, and he was refused. So Liszt's father basically had to go to plan B, and they start to tour at this very, very young age. Then suddenly at age 16, Liszt's father dies in Toulouse. Liszt goes back to Paris to live with his mother, becomes a recluse, hardly touring or performing, but practicing and composing. There was even a notice of his death one day in the local papers. It showed how little people were seeing him of him. In his early years, he heard Paganini play the violin, and Paganini was the great violin virtuoso. And most of us believe this was then the stimulus for him to then to embark on the virtuoso career. And I quote, this is from Liszt writing to a friend after hearing Paganini. For 2 weeks, my mind and my fingers have been working like damned souls. Homer, the Bible, Plato, Locke, Byron, Hugo, Lamartine, Chateaubriand, Beethoven, Bach, Hummel, Mozart, Weber, all are around me. I practice exercises 4 to 5 hours a day, thirds, sixes, octaves, tremolos, repeated notes, cadenzas. Then quote, I am too a painter, cried Michelangelo the first time he saw a masterpiece. Although insignificant and poor, your friend has been repeating unceasingly these words of the great man since the last performance of Paganini. What a man, what a violin, what an artist. Good heavens, how much suffering, misery, and torture in those four strings. Liszt had no formal school training. Yet as you see from his quote, he immersed himself into literature, painting, poetry, and philosophy. The next two pieces were written that we're going to hear were written in the years of touring and were not published until after Liszt retires at the early age of 39. Interesting is that another very famous 19th century composer, Rossini, whose operas are very, very well known, were very popular at this time, just decided to retire at age 40. And Rossini never wrote a piece of music again. Liszt did not retire to quit music. So we are going to start with the L'année de pèlerinage, or the years of pilgrimage. And the first one are the years in Italy. Liszt writes three of these, one for the years in Italy, one for the years in Switzerland, and then really ones based on religious works and his time in Rome. We'll start with this particular piece, which is the Sonata 104, Petrarch, mainly because this was the first piece of Liszt that I heard one day, my teacher playing the piano, that so convinced me that I had to go pursue this man's music. It just touched me so, and I hope it will do the same for you tonight. In your program, I know it's a bit dark, so you probably can't see, and we'll maybe get the lights to turn up a bit, but I've given you the translation of the Petrarch poem. It's pace non trovo, meaning I can find no peace. And basically, the poem Petrarch writes is about his falling in love with this woman in Avignon, where he's living. She's married, she's at court. He will never be able to have an affair with her. But he's deeply in love with her, and she sort of recognizes who he is, but again, it's this unrequited love. And so this confused state of love that Petrarch is in, Liszt tries to achieve in very rapid changes of mood, the highs and lows of romance, and possibly, but not for Petrarch, physical love. There's very contrasting sections, dramatic, often unexpected harmonic shifts. And then there's moments of real calm contemplation and soaring, soaring lines. You have to sort of think of bel canto soprano singing an Italian love song. This is very much, I think, where Liszt is taking his cue. Mark, could you please? Mark Salmon playing Petrarch Sonata in 104, 1835. Screen. Thank you, Mark. So you see why I was so enamored with that piece at an early age. It just, The next piece we are going to hear are from the years of pilgrimage in Switzerland. This is where Liszt runs off with a married countess to start an affair. And they go to Switzerland. It was quite a scandal in its day. But again, this is the Paris society where a lot was accepted and expected. An interesting connection with Geneva and Switzerland and Liszt is that in the late 1980s, I lived in an apartment that I rented from the Boissier family, who actually housed Liszt in this same apartment when he was there in Switzerland. So it all sort of came back in a very interesting way. This piece is also based on a poem by the English poet Byron. It's a very romantic poem. Unfortunately, I missed putting this into the program. But Byron had lived in Geneva about 20 years earlier when he was there with Shelley, and of course that was the great time when Frankenstein was written. This piece, I always feel, is sending you into the ravines and huge valleys of a mountain landscape with large vistas, with snow-capped mountains in the distance. And Liszt here, I feel, is trying to invoke an atmosphere. He's not sticking to a specific movement or form, but is looking for color to help you imagine the landscape that he was so enamored with in Switzerland. And Mark, if you will please come again. And this is the Valet Dobermann. This becomes a very huge piece, so be prepared.
Thank you.
trust you got a sense of some of the peaks and valleys and snow-capped peaks as we see hinted at this picture. That's quite an amazing piece. It's sort of strange to have it in the middle of the program because often that will end a concert evening, as you can imagine. So a little bit more on the life of this amazing man. As I said, Liszt's father, Adam, moved the family to Paris. And so from the age of about 11 or 12 to the age of 27, Paris is his home. And French actually becomes his preferred language. His close friends encouraged his music, molded his philosophy, and cemented a deep religious faith. I'll talk about this deep religious faith later on because it had always been one of the biggest question marks to me, this side of Liszt. A lot of people thought that was a show, but it wasn't, and we'll talk about that. Writers like Victor Hugo, Heinrich Heine, composers like Berlioz, Chopin, Meyerbeer, this was all part of his circle. By the age of 29, though, Liszt is now a father of three children by Countess d'Agoult. And then with a family support, Liszt starts the years of touring from 1839 to 1850, stopping at age 39. He eventually separates with his mistress, Marie d'Agoult. She really couldn't share the stage. When he left the tour, she was extremely jealous. When he came back from touring, she would go into tantrums. It's thought that she had a form of bipolar disorder because even before she met Liszt, she had been institutionalized at one point or another. Anyway, she chooses to reestablish herself in French society, which meant that she abandoned her three children. The three children were then raised by Liszt's mother, Anna, in Paris, sent to private schools, and some of the best that money could buy. And Liszt paid for all of this. His oldest child, Blandine, would marry a future French prime minister. Cosima would eventually divorce her first husband and marry Richard Wagner. And Adam, his youngest, his only boy, died of tuberculosis at the age of 19. During his 20s, Liszt read the works of Lamartine and Lamennais. These are not writers that I had actually run across before I started making notes on this lecture. And I asked friends of mine in France, what is their position in French history? Lamartine's poetry is known by every single school child. Very, very famous poet. He also was a very progressive liberal politician. He actually was the premier of France during the French Commune, which was as near to a communist state that France ever got to. He sort of died in obscurity, disappointed with the rise of Napoleon III. The other very interesting person is Lamennais, who was a Catholic priest. Now, the Catholic Church was completely destroyed by the French Revolution. All the properties were confiscated. It was outlawed to be a priest. And Napoleon eventually brings the Catholic Church back in to sort of buy in with the rising bourgeois and the old aristocracy. But the church, for the most part, had lost its way with the people of France. Less than 90% of Frenchmen were being baptized then. Lamennais solved the problem not with the French people, but with the church. And that the church was too long concentrated on political power, having the right connections with the wealthy families, and ignoring the plight of the poor. He wrote pamphlets and newspaper articles and books about the rights of the worker, that there should be a limit to work hours each day, that there should be a vacation period, there should be a day off per week. There was something considered a just wage for work, and that public education would be something that the church should push for among the poor. The church in Rome was not exactly in sync with this idea, and he's eventually excommunicated. He gives up the whole Catholic religion and is actually buried without Catholic ceremony. But these two men were sort of mentors to Liszt in his vulnerable ages in his 20s. So instead of a young, handsome 20-year-old running around Paris, living up the high life, I think Liszt saw that because of his genius, because of his gift, these men showed him that he had something special to give, and that he did not have time to, you know, have the high life. And also that when it came to his time, to give back, and he does give back in a major way. This is Paganini, who, as I mentioned earlier, was the inspiration for Liszt. And Liszt basically was going to imitate what Paganini could do with the audience, and that is dazzle them with his technique. Except Liszt takes it a step further. Instead of just being part of an evening's retinue of singers, jugglers, orchestra pieces, almost like a potpourri of theater works, Liszt did a solo evening just of himself. No one had done this before. And he charged the same price for his tickets as you would have paid if you had a whole retinue of performers. This was unique, and also Liszt played basically all the known piano literature at that time. Bach, Scarlatti, to Beethoven, Mozart, Schubert, Chopin. And then he transcribed many of the current operas, Bellini, Rossini. He even transcribed Beethoven symphonies and Bach organ fugues. By the time he plays in St. Petersburg, towards the end of his touring, his audience is now reaching 3,000. Never before had a single artist achieved such a following, and a paying one at that. Liszt was probably the most caricatured person of the 19th century. Because of his fame, he was the object of a lot of ridicule, especially from so-called music critics. A music critic back then basically knew how to write. He really didn't know much about music. And Liszt would trump them up by changing the order of the music he played from what was printed in the program, so that when the critic the next day said this interpretation of Beethoven was horrible, he would point out that he hadn't actually played Beethoven at that point, that it was Clementi. He did perform his own music, but like I said, he was championing music, especially of composers that who had almost been forgotten. We cannot imagine Beethoven's sonatas being almost forgotten, but they were very difficult to play. And then, of course, Schubert's music was just being discovered. And the Liszt performance? Well, this is say that Liszt went so far as to say that he played the room to the point of wearing white gloves onto the stage. He had actually was the first person to enter from the wings of the stage. He was the first person to have the piano situated so that you have the wing of the piano opening up to the audience. Beforehand, the back of the pianist is what you saw, and the piano was completely in a perpendicular position from what it is now. As you can tell, this is much better for the sound of the piano, and also you get to watch the performer. By the time Liszt arrives in Berlin, he plays 10 concerts over a period of 2 weeks. And it was so astounding that Heinrich Heine, the famous German exile poet living in Paris, coined the phrase Litzomania, because people were literally going in crazy during his concerts. I mean, we know that phenomenon today, but back then that had never happened before. When Liszt left Berlin, he was escorted in a carriage of 4 white horses by a cavalry guard of the leading noblemen of Berlin. And when they passed the royal palace, the king and queen of Prussia, they weren't yet Kaisers then, came to the balcony to wave him goodbye. Now, never before did an artist get this kind of respect. Now we're going to take a switch into the more intimate part of Liszt, and that is his songs. We're going to be doing 3 songs. which he wrote in his middle period. Here, Liszt is moving forward. Yes, he knew Schubert's songs intimately, transcribed over 50 of them for solo piano. But here, he's moving forward. The first two will remind you of the great late 19th century Germanic writers, Gustav Mahler and Richard Strauss. And again, in your program, is the poetry that these are written on. So do peruse the poetry. It really does help to get a sense of what is being said in these poems. The first one is just how wonderful it is to be in love. And there's it's just a very beautiful, brief poem that just shows this sort of ecstasy of love. The second one is really more of a lullaby. And you can take the person that Holly is singing to either as her lover or as her baby. Either one could be, because you would call your little child mein Liebe, my love. And what's incredible is that Liszt is asking the singer to move up in octaves, but kling leise, sing softly. and Holly does it beautifully, you will hear. The last one is a poem by Victor Hugo. It's a very romantic poem. And when you hear it, you will be thinking of Gounod or Saint-Saëns. You can almost hear Samson Delilah in this. You will see what I meant, how international Liszt is as a composer. So let's just give me a few moments to set up the piano, and we will then hear three songs by Franz Liszt. Please, Holly.
This might seem crazy that we lower and raise the piano bench, but it's actually very, very critical that you're at a good angle and the right height. So you don't play like this or play like that. Thank you.
sie sorgt für die rankenden Baum, in Liebe umschlingt mit dem blühenden Traum und singe versucht, wie die Nacht singt, die die Rose den klingenden Schneewittchen bringt. Stimmischem Grüß, tritt behutsam nur auf, wie des Königs Fuß, der hindurch den heiligen Tempel geht, still klingelt ein Grüß, wie ein leises Gebet. Thank you.
As you can see, there are some amazingly beautiful, beautiful sides of the list. His song, his leader, and French chanson and Italian songs are just incredibly hidden works of treasure. So do explore them, you know, on iTunes or in YouTube. There are just some beautiful, beautiful pieces there. So this is not going to be a geography, a lesson per se, but I think it's interesting to put in perspective the major changes that Europe is going through during the life of Liszt. This is a map of Europe in 1848, and as I said, that was a very, very tumultuous time. There was a revolution in Paris, there was a revolution in Vienna, there was a revolution in Frankfurt. A lot of governments toppled, but the old order reestablished itself. But during this time, borders were closing. It was actually literally dangerous to travel. And so it's at this point that Liszt decides to quit touring. However, what I also like to point out is that by 1870, when Liszt is 60, and he'll be spending part of his year in Weimar, which is in southern Germany, part of the year in Rome, and then part of the year in Budapest. The big change now is that Liszt doesn't have to travel by stagecoach. All the major cities are connected by railroad. Liszt, by the way, always traveled third class with his valet. He never traveled first class. The big changes here is to notice Italy is now united. There are no papal states. Austria has lost Tuscany. The king of Savoy has become the king of Italy. France's border with Germany has been realigned because they lost the Franco-Prussian War. The outcome of the Franco-Prussian War is that Prussia now is the Empire of Germany, and the König is now Kaiser. The Austria-Hungarian Empire is still existing, so there's no Hungary, there's no Poland, but the Balkan states are beginning to form. Greece gets its independence as well as some of the smaller states. But as we see, Russia is still occupying Warsaw, there's no Poland, and actually Belgium separates from the Netherlands. But as you see, basically the modern map of Europe today has been formed. By 1848, Liszt receives, does his, one of his last concerts in Kiev, in the Ukraine. And he receives a large donation for a charity concert he was giving. And he insisted on meeting the donor of that large gift. And it was Princess Caroline von Sayn-Wittgenstein. She was a wealthy married heiress, though already estranged from her husband. It was an arranged marriage. But she inherited from her father so many acres that it took her 4 days on horseback to go from one end to the next. She owned over 60,000 serfs. Now, the system of serfdom was that the serfs raised the crops, harvested. They kept 10%, and they tried to survive the next winter on that. The 90% went to the owners. And she was one of the largest grain dealers coming out of the Ukraine. She was not a beautiful woman per se, but extremely well-read, very outspoken, and completely supportive of Liszt's decision to stop touring and take up composing and conducting. And she is at his side for the next 30 years. Liszt and Princess Caroline planned her escape, which was difficult because the borders were closing and she wasn't allowed to take money out. So she secretly sells properties in Kiev and literally, you know, sews, you know, gold coins into her clothes and leaves with her daughter and meets Liszt in Austria. And then they eventually reside in Weimar together for the next 10 to 15 years. This period in Weimar is probably his happiest period. He no longer has the strains of touring. He can devote himself to composition. Liszt would compose regularly, every single day, 4 to 6 hours. Then he would teach, he would then conduct. As I mentioned earlier, the advances that Liszt made in conducting. Up to that point, typically, when you went to go hear an orchestra performance, the musicians in the orchestra probably had seen the music one day before. Maybe they had practiced 2 or 3 times. Now you can imagine if it's a new piece by Wagner or a huge major symphony by Beethoven. I mean, no orchestra today would dare try and pull that off with, you know, 1 or 2 rehearsals. Liszt was also the first to take sections, the string section, the horn section, the woodwinds, and practice them solo so that they could really get to know their part. One of the great students of Liszt, sorry, I hit the wrong button here, is Hans von Bülow, who eventually becomes the conductor for the Berlin Philharmonic. And the Berlin Philharmonic has its name today basically because of von Bülow. When he first started to conduct, he took his cue from Liszt. He, of course, conducted totally from memory, as Liszt would, but he made all the musicians of the orchestra learn their parts by heart, by memory. No one does that today, you know. But you can imagine the degree of performance that it achieved, and thus your audience was becoming habituated to hearing excellent performance and not just some throw-together achievement. There's probably the best drawing or painting I could find of Princess Caroline. Like I said, she was not a beautiful woman. She was devoted to her daughter, Marie. The other person up there you see is Richard Wagner. Wagner was involved with a revolution in 1848 in Dresden. And they lost out. And the rabble-rousers, or revolutionaries, were summarily arrested and shot. Wagner escapes to Weimar, and Liszt, together with help of France, sends him off to Switzerland and basically then supports him for the next number of years while he's in exile. But Liszt saves the life of Wagner. And then while Wagner is in exile, nobody would dare touch his music but Liszt. And so the premiere of Tristan and Isolde and a lot of Wagner's operas are done by Liszt. However, as often with great men, there is great tragedy. And Liszt, as I said, had lost his 2 other children, Blondine in childbirth, and his son by TB. The only remaining middle child, Cosima, was married to von Bülow originally. While they're living in Munich, and von Bülow is conducting the operas of Wagner for King Ludwig, the Mad King of Bavaria, Cosima and Wagner have an affair. And after she has his second child, the city of Munich says, "We've had enough. You got to divorce and marry Wagner." But that meant she renounced her Catholic faith to marry Protestant Wagner. Liszt, a devout Catholic, was devastated. Not only was he betrayed by his dear friend who he had supported and saved his life, Wagner, but by his only child. And they were estranged for a number of years. So I'm trying to give you little bits and pieces of biographical information about Liszt, but let's go back to his music. This is written during the Weimar years, the Harmonies du Soir, which is part of the Transcendental Etudes. These are some of the most, it's a collection of etudes, but they're some of the most challenging works ever written for piano. However, Liszt is no longer here writing to dazzle you with his pyrotechnics. The technique that he is bringing into these pieces is to create color. Almost to give you an orchestral tonal adventure. This piece will remind those of you who know Debussy's The Sunken Cathedral, La Cathédrale Engloutie. You'll hear, like in the first five pages of this piece, it's very reminiscent of Debussy. And Debussy knew this piece quite well. But then there's a section which will come back a number of times that starts softly with these big, big chords. And then it just builds and it builds and it builds. And it is an incredible challenge for the pianist. But thank goodness we have Mark tonight who takes on this challenge and with quite bravura so that we can enjoy this beautiful, beautiful piece. So Harmonies du Soir from the Transcendental Etudes. Mark, please.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Moments in that piece, I almost start to hyperventilate. But what's amazing, though, Liszt really understands the range of emotion, but he also understands at this period, especially in his life, bringing it all down. I mean, he brought you to a huge, huge dynamic level, but as you saw, the piece brings you down, gets you to a normal, heart rate again, almost. Probably the best known genre of Liszt works are the Hungarian Rhapsodies. There's the famous cartoon of Bugs Bunny playing the famous Second Hungarian Rhapsody at the piano and making it extremely funny and hilarious. It's not hilarious to try and play it though. It's quite a work. But Liszt was enamored with, especially the gypsy music in Hungary. He made a big mistake thinking that Hungarian music came from the gypsies. Actually, it was the other way around, as they later found out through studies, especially by Bartok. But Liszt was actually the first person to make any effort to try and understand the ethnic origins of a lot of the music throughout Europe. The first 15 rhapsodies were written between 1851 and 1853, but the last four are from his very late period, 1882, 1886. This is when he's in his early 70s. But by this time, Liszt music is completely ignored by the general public of the 19th century, and he doesn't make any effort to push it upon his students. He almost writes thinking no one will ever hear this. It really wasn't until after World War II that a lot of this music was even published for the first time. The Rhapsody we're going to hear is the 17th, and it shows you the direction this is going. You almost have to start thinking of Bartok, Prokofiev, Scriabin when you hear this piece. It's rather short, but you almost get the sense of some anger here. And realize, when the Austrians put down the Hungarian Revolution of 1848, they executed many of the dear friends that Liszt had in Budapest. So even though he kept his mouth shut and did not get openly involved in politics, I get a sense of his rage in this Hungarian Rhapsody number 70. Please, Mark.
Thank you.
The final piece, and I'm sort of gonna press for time here because I have so many notes. There's so many things I'd love to tell you, but there is a limit in time. The last piece we'll hear tonight before I take Q&A is called Jeudeau de la Villa d'Este. And I don't know if any of you all have been to Tivoli outside of Rome, but this is a very famous palace, the Villa d'Este. And at this time in Liszt's life, while he's living in Rome, he is given a cell at this place. It's owned by Cardinal von Hohenhola, who is from a very, very wealthy, influential Catholic family of Prussia. Prussia's mostly Protestant, so being Catholic gave you sort of a special status, and he was the ambassador of Germany to Rome. Interesting enough, his nephew ends up marrying Princess Caroline's daughter, Marie. And we think this is the major reason why Liszt and Caroline were never given annulment of her first marriage so they could marry themselves. That's when Liszt decides to go take holy orders. This piece definitely is pointing towards the future, and Liszt is opening up a whole new genre of music, the Impressionism. We seriously think that Debussy, he was in Rome at this time that Liszt was writing this piece. He had won the Prix de Rome as a very young composer, and he met Liszt, and it could easily possible that Liszt played this or played snippets of it. In any case, Liszt and Ravel both took up on this idea of water, and you definitely will be hearing, at least I hear, you know, the droplets and all the various streams and fountains gushing forth on this. It's really quite an amazing piece.
Thank you.
Well, Franz Liszt, he's about 75 years old, not in great health, but yet still traveling and conducting and hosting performances. His daughter, Cosima, is now a widow. Wagner had died about 10 years earlier, and she's trying to make Bayreuth, which is the huge, huge theater that Wagner had built specifically for his operas. She's trying to start this sort of Bayreuth festival, which is a big, big function in German culture today. But it was a tough going in the beginning. And so despite Liszt's very, very poor health at 75, she pushes him to come because just bringing Liszt into the audience, having his presence there, would sell tickets. He comes, and they perform Tristan and Isolde, and he unfortunately dies of pneumonia that night. Cosima was a little bit upset because it sort of put the damper on her festival. She was just going to have some simple little funeral, nobody around, and his students just completely said no. But this is buried at Bayreuth. But his last words, I think, and I'll stop here and then start with Q&A. He takes the final words of Tristan in the opera. "You were right. I don't know if life is greater than death, but love was more than either." And I think that sums up this man. He loved music. He loved the musicians, no matter how they betrayed him. He put that all aside to promote culture in his time. And we have the school piano playing. Practically all great pianists can trace their teachers back in lineage to Liszt. He did a tremendous amount for orchestration, for developing the orchestra as it is today. Like I said, his choral music, there is a huge amount, and I should be always using that word huge, but I love it. But there is a large literature there. He wrote the 13 stages of the cross. He wrote two masses. He wrote the whole life of Christ from the beginning to the end. It's like 4 hours, so you got a lot there. Let's take some questions. No questions? Nobody has any doubts? Good question. We think he wrote an opera when he was in his 20s. It failed, but no. It was not a genre he pursued. I think a lot of that choice is because Wagner was on the scene, and he didn't really want to go up against his future son-in-law. Question back there? We have one back there.
Did women really faint at his concerts when he was younger?
The question, did women faint at his concerts? Yes, they did. The hysteria had never been seen in Europe before. I mean, we know it now because, you know, even as kids, we went to pop concerts. We could still see, you know, young kids, even adults, you know, just going mad in the pyrotechnics. So it's not unheard of, but never before had people seen such a performance at the piano. And he played to the room and wasn't, you know, embarrassed of it. But I think that's why he decided to quit, because it was detracting from the real music he wanted to do. Yes, back there.
Did he take holy orders out of devotion or economics or disappointment in love?
The question was, did he take religious orders out of real religious feeling, out of economics, or out of unrequited love? He and Caroline still loved each other, but marriage was off the books. And he was suffering through tremendous bouts of depression. Liszt, from his 20s on, went to Mass every day. So he was a very devout Catholic. One of the things he was trying to do was reform the music in the church. He was the first one to start bringing Gregorian chant polyphony from the Renaissance. You can hear it in his choral works, because at that time, church music, what they basically did was take the latest hot tune from the opera stage and sing it for Holy Communion, and he thought this was disgraceful. So he had his whole plan to reform church music, which of course met up with the curia and the hierarchy of the church. It is probably the most difficult of all sides of the list to come to terms with. He definitely didn't need to become an abbe for economic reasons, and he got no remuneration from the church. It was, I think, a way for him to sort of reconcile what was going on around in his life. It's probably one of the most difficult things when you see the character of Liszt to put that in as part of the whole puzzle. Yes, please.
Liszt is considered a modernist.
Yes.
So he is. Modernism?
Actually, his students coined the phrase Musik der Zukunft, music of the future. And then they used the word modernism because they thought it was sort of presumptuous to say this is what the future will be. But that was sort of there were two factions of music in Germany at that time. One was based in Leipzig, which was Brahms and sort of very traditional. The only thing we should take cue from is Beethoven and Mozart, and that's all we needed. And then there was the other side, Liszt, who was pushing Wagner and other composers who were experimenting with form, with sound. His music is definitely of modernism. And I think that's why he started to attract composers and musicians after World War II, when the big push from the music schools was, okay, let's start exploring music that has not been done, typically in the concert halls. The music of the future is often what it was called in his day. Yes?
The piano itself changed quite a bit from this youth to his old age. How did the technical advances of the piano show up in his music?
It's a good question. We touched on that a bit in the Chopin, because of course Chopin is living through a greater part of the same period as Liszt, and they both lived in Paris, and at that time Erard and Pleyel were making a major advancements. The big advancement that happened around the 1830s was the double escapement, which allowed fast repeated notes, and also if you could have done a very light touch to still keep control. Obviously, the metal frame, no longer a wooden frame for your strings, allowed a much bigger sound and a much more stable sound. You didn't have pianos falling apart on stage. The thing is that Liszt, kept on with the piano maker to experiment with all kinds of things. He had this weird, weird instrument in his house in Weimar that had pedals like an organ. And you can imagine the size of these strings that, the pedals would play. It never caught on. But interesting, in his room in Weimar, he had a little spinet that was owned by Mozart. So he started as a child with these very, very fragile wooden pianos and saw the change. And I think, especially in the Transcendental Etudes, he is doing things that probably he wouldn't have tried to do in the 1830s. It made a huge difference in what he could eventually write, that the modern piano came about at that same time. Well, thank you. Oh, Holly, are you back there? Oh, come on, Holly, we thought you had left. Come on, please. Thank you, and good night.